Today, we're going to continue our discussion about question answering, but now we're going to bring more and more of our discussion into the modern era by talking about neural information retrieval as a part of a question answering system. In previous lectures, we talked about the way that you can answer a question. You have some collection of evidence in Wikipedia, a question comes in, you use that question to find relevant documents in your document collection, and then you run a reader to find the answer somewhere in this evidence. Today we're going to talk about how we can do that a little bit better with the fancy tools that we talked about in previous lectures, tools like BERT, and how these new techniques for doing question answering unlocks exciting new advances. The stuff that is now possible is called deep retrieval. Instead of using a traditional information retrieval system, we'll use deep learning to turn both our queries and our evidence into vectors. And we'll see how this is not just better, but can also be more cost-effective. Now, you remember how a traditional information retrieval system works. You get a sparse vector with weights for individual words. How those weights are assigned or set isn't really important. It could be TF-IDF, BM25, or just raw word counts. Let's focus, however, on the dimensionality, how big this vector is, and how you can match these large vectors in a very high dimensional space. First, the dimensionality is in the tens or even hundreds of thousands. There are many, many words in English, particularly if you want to be able to match very specific terms that you see in questions like the Treaty of Westphalia or transposon or Uluru or Murasaki. If you want to be able to match these very specific high TF-IDF weight terms, you're going to need to have a really large vector. There are good algorithms for searching through this space, however, made by Maryland's own David Mount, but you can't do it exactly. Once the dimensionality gets high enough, you're going to have to do some sort of approximate search for the nearest neighbors. If you can't do an exact search in high dimensions, then why keep all of these dimensions around in the first place? A seminal paper called Minwise Independent Permutation said that you shouldn't do this for big sparse vectors. Instead, create new vectors and do your computation in a lower dimensional space instead. If you use hash functions based on some distance function, for example, cosine similarity, our old friend, if you use some distance function like that to create these representations, this is called locality-sensitive hashing. The basic idea that we won't cover here in detail is that you can have a bunch of functions that divide the vector space in half, and if you have enough of these, you can compute approximations of similarity very efficiently. This idea was created for the old school search engine AltaVista. Please leave a comment in the description if you remember AltaVista and tell these whippersnappers to get off of our lawns. I remember that locality-sensitive hashing was a really hot topic at the beginning of the 21st century. It was just becoming popular as I was a grad student at Princeton. Moses Charikar there was a professor there, and he was just sinking his teeth into this problem. And with this sort of approach, you could do faster computations with less memory. These sorts of approaches are fast and good, but can neural networks be even better? And the answer is yes. Otherwise, why would I be talking about these ancient algorithms from the turn of the century in a lecture about BERT for deep retrieval? The algorithms that were developed to do comparisons and searches in this lower dimensional space can be repurposed for the representations created by deep learning algorithms. And the idea is the same. Create representations specific to your task. But other than having access to distance functions, the hash functions in LSH don't really understand language. But let's get to what I really want to talk about, which is how these representations can be not just faster, but also better. Can we create representations tailor-made for a task like question answering? To do that, let's talk about a concept called trigger words in the trivia community. This is a term popularized by Bob Harris in his book, The Prisoner of Trebekistan. Sometimes TF-IDF is good at finding these sorts of terms. If you have a good TF-IDF clue in a question like, what do you need the Hal-Hero process for? It's fairly easy to map that query term to aluminum. When you have specific words that only correspond to one answer, TF-IDF is great. But what if you have a sequence of words that aren't TF-IDF, like who said to be or not to be? Now, you could add in gram dimensions to capture the specific sequence of tokens to be or not to be, but that would explode the dimensionality even more. Even worse, sometimes people asking questions, particularly in the Manchester paradigm that we talked about before, can be tricky. If the question is about Lübeck, a city that was part of the Hanseatic League, the question writer might be tricky and say something like, a city on the Trava that was a member of the Confederation of the Baltic Cities, instead of mentioning the Hanseatic League by name. So how could you have a system that learns to map these sorts of words to the things that you need to answer? This is where frameworks like PyTorch that we've been talking about really show their usefulness. You can create a giant computation graph that not only learns a representation of a question, but also of the evidence passages where you can easily find the answer. So now you learn to push who said to be or not to be close to the evidence passages that contain Hamlet. And city on the Trava that was a member of the Confederation of Baltic Cities close to the evidence passages that contain Lübeck. And you can use your favorite neural network to encode both sides. Today you'd use BERT to do this. In 2015, we used our deep averaging network. Here are, for example, the US presidents going in a clockwise order from the founding fathers to the 19th century presidents to the 20th century presidents. And this structure is present in hundreds of dimensions. Here we've projected it down to two dimensions with a T-SNE projection. There have been a lot of papers recently doing this. At the end of the 2010s, there were three big papers that came out proposing ways of learning encodings for evidence and questions simultaneously. The three papers are ORCA, Open Retrieval for Question Answering, RELM, Retrieval Augmented Language Model Pre-Training, and DPR, Dense Passage Retrieval. Dense Passage Retrieval, DPR, is the latest. It builds on the others and probably has the best code available if you actually want to use this. But ORCA and RELM came out a little bit first. So I'm going to talk primarily about those since many of the innovations were there. DPR is probably the best one to use, and it's a little bit better, it seems. So what do these papers say? ORCA showed that it was possible to do neural retrieval better than off-the-shelf IR. RELM improved the pre-training, doing masking of spans that are likely to be the answer. Instead of BERT, which masks out a random 15% of tokens, they now mask named entities and dates. Let's see an example of what this means. Let's say you have text that says, during this conflict, Celia Sanchez created a farmer's militia in order to supply troops and worked with Frank Pai to create a task force. This could be a quizzable question or it could be a Wikipedia page. Again, we're not doing the embedding yet. We're just treating it as raw text that you can use for BERT pre-chaining. Is there anything we can do to improve BERT via pre-training? RELM argues that if you mask these tokens, Rather than a random 15% of tokens, you get encoders that do a better job of keeping track of where entities start and end. When your job is to highlight entities in a passage, this entity focus pre-training gets you better representations. That's because entities, dates, people, organizations are more likely to be the answers to questions. And doing masking in this way tells Bert, hey, this is the stuff you really need to pay attention to. Let's take a look at this figure that discusses how you should get your negative samples. Their suggestion is to use all of the negative samples from a single batch. So remember, a batch is the group of data items that you feed into your optimizer for a single gradient step. Obviously, the positive example for question two training is the evidence passage that contains the answer for question two. But what should you use as negative evidence? The DPR paper argues that you should use in-batch negatives and take all of the negative examples for everything else in the batch. Now, how do you get those negative examples? Again, the DPR paper argues that this should be traditional answers from an IR system that have high TF-IDF, BM25, what have you, scores, but don't have the right answer. And these should come from not just the results for question two, but everything else in your batch. It's not a huge difference, but this in-batch training does seem to help. So let's wrap up. These models allow us to not just match words from questions and answers, but to learn arbitrary matchings between questions and answers. I think that we've only begun to scratch the possibilities for this kind of system, and recent research is looking into these opportunities. In the previous video, we talked about how BERT can find answer spans in questions. How does this combine with deep retrieval? In some ways, it makes difficult problems go away. Instead of just indexing entire documents, you can encode the things that BERT can encode well. Wikipedia paragraphs, for instance. Then you don't have to bother splitting things up. You retrieve the paragraphs rather than the pages that are likely to have the answer that you're looking for. So if you're going to use BERT anyway for span finding, because it's better than sequence-based methods that came before it, why not go all the way and use it for the retrieval as well? You'll fix two problems at once. But there are other ways that deep retrieval is better as well. Dense passage retrieval lets you find answers to questions like, how was the Monkey King born? But since we're doing the lookup in an arbitrary vector space, we could train our question encoder to take input in any language. All that matters is the resulting vector space. And does it line up or not? If the encoder can handle, say, Chinese input, and we have the appropriate training data, we can find answers in any language. But then why does it even have to be text? We can encode any object as a vector, so why not answer questions with an image? So to recap, we started using dense passage retrieval because we didn't want to put up with thousands of types defining our vocabulary, but we ended up with something that can do image retrieval. This shows the power of representation learning, and people were doing this before BERT, but it's even more powerful now that we have these stronger models. So perhaps a picture is worth a thousand words, at least in terms of dimensionality. If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.